experience, the one that comes afterwards is the one that counts, right? Well, we don't have much time to present, so I am trying to give to you one or two very salient points about what might just be called the theological assumptions of religious liberty, or at least the theological assumptions under the idea of a Christian person. My task is to present a theological perspective to the issue of religious liberty, perhaps even to provide a Lutheran touch to the problem. I must confess, however, at the very beginning, to a bit of conceptual skepticism. Had Martin Luther been asked whether a mosque might be built in Wittenberg, it is wholly unthinkable that he would have appealed to the notion of religious liberty and have given an answer in the affirmative. After all, the people of Europe, certainly those of Germany, were a Christian people. They were to be governed by a Christian king, to be governed according to laws, if not derived from, at least in harmony with the perspective of the scriptures. I'm not sure that I can even think of a people in the ancient or medieval centuries who did not consider their rulers to be, in some manner, representatives or even images of the divine. To the Roman mind, for example, the emperor was Pontifex Maximus, highest priest. He performed public cultic duty to express Rome's honor to the gods, with the hope and expectation that such honor would lead the gods to give to the empire peace and prosperity. Early Christian martyrs, therefore, were condemned for the crime of maiestas, treason, or the crime of odium humani generis, hatred of the human race, because they would not participate in those public ceremonies which honored the gods, who, according to their conviction, did not exist. Religious liberty is not, strictly speaking, a theological notion. It is a political one. The notion arises when political and governmental powers declare themselves to be neutral in matters of faith and morals. In our Western world, as far as I can tell, the idea arises as a practical matter out of the Enlightenment ideas of the proper function of the state and of the limitations to be placed upon the state. According to this notion, our country has in fact been quite blessed by the intuitions of our founding fathers. George Mason, the architect of the Virginia Declaration of Rights, a document antecedent to the Constitution, began the Declaration with these words, that all men are born equally free and independent. He then continued, all men should enjoy the fullest toleration in the exercise of religion, according to the dictates of conscience, unpunished and unrestrained by the magistrate. Interestingly and significantly, James Madison was not fully pleased with that language. The language of fullest toleration was insufficient to ground adequately the notion that religious liberty was an inherent personal right rather than a mere limit upon the state, which the state imposed upon itself. Religious liberty and the exercise of it were not merely to be tolerated by the state to some fullest extent. Rather, religious liberty was the inherent right of man endowed by his Creator with it, and as such a right which precedes and is more fundamental than any human arrangement or any earthly power. Governments are therefore legitimate and exercise their authority within proper limits, Only when they protect such rights, guard and defend such rights against any and all encroachments against them. And so James Madison advanced an amendment to the Declaration, establishing absolute religious freedom. The result of that discussion was that Mason's fullest toleration in the exercise of religion became the free exercise of religion. It is the fundamental human right, a privilege of nature, that every man should worship according to one's own convictions. So Madison. Madison's intuition that religious liberty was of nature and not of human law or governmental allowance echoes sentiments voiced long ago by the early Christian thinker Tertullian. He wrote of the libertas religionis, the freedom to be bound to one's own convictions. There is, however, a difference. Madison was a political thinker. Religious liberty was a right of man given by God, and so religious freedom limited government. This concept of liberty assisted Madison to divine the proper and necessary duties of government, and to do so without entertaining the difficult questions of right and authority which had bedeviled earlier societies which grounded political power in divine law. Tertullian, on the other hand, is not thinking as a political thinker. He is not considering the freedom of religion as that exercised within a civil or political entity. He writes as a Christian thinker. In his vocabulary, libertas religionis is virtually a definition of man. In classical Latin, certainly in ecclesiastical Latin, the term religio was derived from the verb ligare, to bind. The verb which also lay behind the term lex, or law. Thus the term religio came to be virtually synonymous with the term obligatio, duty or obligation. For Tertullian, therefore, thinking as a Christian, the term libertas religionis had broad, all-encompassing significance. The term expressed nothing else than the reality of the existence of the Christian human person in the world. To that claim, two qualifications are necessary. Firstly, the existence of the human person in the world is not a mere abstraction, a mere presence. The human person lives, and so the human person acts and thinks and speaks according to the truth of his own personal reality. That a person lives gives expression to the obligatio, or the duty aspect of the freedom of religion. To be true to one's own personal reality, one must live according to that reality. One is bound to one's own personal truth. Note, bound, not to one's personal opinions, but to the truth of one's person, to thine own self be true. Secondly, for Christian Tertullian, one is bound not to any law, but to God, and ultimately to his gospel. Nor is this being bound to God something external to the reality of man that limits man, hedges him in. Man is not bound to God as to something alien or limiting. Man is the effect of the divine breath. God formed man out of the dust of the ground, breathed into his nostrils, and man became a living being. This is what it means for a man to be in the image of God. Man chooses to exist in the world, to be manifest and to be known in the world. But by way of that creature, whose life is to be the image of God's own word and will. Thus, throughout the Torah, Israel is reminded that its wisdom and strength and prosperity lies in obedience to God's word. Deuteronomy 8 is classic. That you might know that man does not live by bread alone, but that man lives by everything that proceeds out of the mouth of God. According to Matthew, Jesus quoted those words to explain why he would not cave in to the tempter's delusion that he prove himself the Son of God by way of works of power. The freedom of religion, of which Tertullian speaks, therefore, lies within man's nature. When man is bound to God, he is free to live according to his nature. Being bound to God does not limit. It opens man up to the full exercise of his human personhood. Man is true to his reality as God's image then and only then when he instantiates in his life and thought the truth of God himself. A higher view of man's integrity is hardly imagined. A more noble understanding of man's place in the world cannot, I would suggest, be found in the annals of human thought other than in the biblical perspective. Yet, in view of our purpose here today, we must note that this view claims the human person to be the most fundamental reality in the realm of creation. Not, we must hasten to add, the human person in some independent autonomy, which is always delusional, but the human person precisely in his being bound to the Word of God. The human person thus bound is true to the human truth. For this reason, the Christian faithful follow and worship Jesus, for according to the Gospel of John, Jesus is none but the Word become flesh. That is, he manifests and is the reality of God precisely in his human reality. Those of you familiar with the Christian confession will recognize the doxological claim, Verus Deus, Verus Homo, true God, true man. However, we must take account of a second implication of this understanding. Since the reality of man implies intrinsically obedience to God, all human powers, all human forms and arrangements, including that of the government and the state, are fundamentally penultimate and indeed destined to pass away. Despite the appearance of stability, endurance, or even invincibility, that the human vessels of power and authority may have, there is in fact a certain vaporous quality that the scriptures give to earthly powers. Put not your trust in princes, in a son of man in whom there is no help. When his breath departs, he returns to his earth, and on that very day, his plans perish. But how the psalmist now continues is crucial. Blessed is he whose help is the God of Jacob, whose help is the Lord, his God who made the heavens and the earth. And thereupon the psalmist mentions various works of God, who as creator continues to perform that work which is proper to him, to give justice to the oppressed, food to the hungry, frees the prisoner, makes the blind to see, upholds the widow and the orphan. And if we ask by what means God does these things, and other such things, the answer is precisely through those whose hope is in the Lord. Such works are true to the reality of man. As image of God, man does the works which are proper to God the Creator, whose proper work it is to give life, to maintain and sustain it. If that work is not done by those of faith, then God remains inactive. From this perspective, princes become wicked, to use the biblical term, should they impede or prohibit such activities, or promote activities contrary or hostile to them? An example. What are we to think when governments such as that of the state of Massachusetts, Illinois, Washington, D.C., demand the closing of Catholic adoption agencies when those agencies refuse to act contrary to conscience and then to place children into same-sex families? Quite apart from the fact that other avenues for such adoption might exist, does such government clout promote or prohibit what the psalmist calls upholding the fatherless? Prohibiting the exercise of that which is good places such government in opposition, not simply to some moral imperative, but in opposition to the integrity of the human person, both that of the worker as well as that of the receiver. I believe in one God, maker of heaven and earth. In that confession, all earthly power is rendered penultimate, both in terms of legitimate power as well as in that of purpose. In the 1930s, when National Socialism was gaining ascendancy, a German Catholic theologian by the name of Erich Peterson wrote two small but influential books. On the surface, both books seem self-evident theological tractates, but both had important and powerful political messages. The first little book was entitled Monotheismus als politisches Problem, Monotheism as a political problem. And it reflected on the fact that monotheistic faith precludes all pretensions to absolute power by earthly government. Moreover, monotheistic faith precludes the full submission to earthly powers asserting such pretensions. You shall have no other gods before me. That may seem to be a religious claim, but in fact, it harbors within itself significant implications about the place and rule of all earthly arrangements. The second little book by Peterson, entitled Liturgie der Engel, or Liturgy of the Angels, argued the thesis that the Christian liturgy entailed within itself a powerful critique against all the public displays of totalitarian power. As you know, Hitler's Germany, as well as the Soviet Union, had numerous displays of state power and the cultus of leadership. Christian liturgy, addressing ultimate loyalties and ultimate commitments to God only, declares such state liturgies false worship and places the faithful in opposition to that pomp and circumstance, which, if raising its head against God, is the pomp and circumstance of the devil. The argument of Peterson was hardly recent. It is reported that when the Roman governor demanded that Polycarp, Christian bishop, to swear by the genius of the emperor, that is, to acknowledge Rome's demand to receive homage, Polycarp replied, "For 86 years I have been a servant of Christ. How am I now to blaspheme against my king?" However attenuated the Christian clarity of our founding fathers might have been, their insistent claim that religious liberty entailed the exercise of religious conscience was of a piece with long-standing understandings of man as a creature of God, whose freedom lies precisely in his being bound to a transcendent will, and whose lived freedom arises precisely from that being bound. The political notion, then, that derives from the Judeo-Christian mind, or at least is consonant with it, and that informed the thought of America's forefathers, was that fundamental rights were endowed by God to man, and no government which persecutes or prohibits the exercise of those rights could be regarded as legitimate. There was a religious notion at the very basis of the constitutional fact. But therein lay a potential problem, which today is more than evident. Law and rights preceded all enacted laws and rights. No constitution or written law is thus strong enough to defend and uphold freedom and right if the people themselves cease to acknowledge such freedom and such rights as transcendental gifts. America was built not on antecedent statutes, but on an idea, a religious idea concerning the nature of man as the repository of rights and duties given by God. Ideas, however, must be rethought, and they must be reappropriated if they are to remain living and formative ideas. John Adams, our second president, forewarned of consequences should the people for whom the Constitution was framed cease to be a people governed from the inside by the ideas and notions therein expressed. He said, "We have no government armed in power, capable of contending with human passions unbridled by morality and religion. Our Constitution was made only for a religious and moral people. It is wholly inadequate for the government of any other." Adams, a classical scholar in his own right, understood the notion of religio, a people unbridled by transcendental norms will inevitably descend to the unbridled whim of human passion and the competing demands of self-interest. If laws become but the expression of human passion or the mere facade behind which self-interest and power claim legitimacy, then no constitution, however venerable, will be able to preserve and promote those rights whose origin lies in the providential goodness of God. Jefferson as well realized that the stability of the American idea could only stand if its citizens remained firm in their support of the transcendental ground of their own rights. He wrote, "Can the liberties of a nation be thought secure when we have removed their only firm basis, namely a conviction in the minds of the people that these liberties are the gift of God?" The firm basis for the securing, protection, and promotion of liberty lies then in the minds of the people that these liberties are the gift of God. But what happens if the minds of the people change? In 1984, Richard John Neuhouse wrote a book entitled The Naked Public Square. He noted already at that time the encroachment of a public sentiment which ruled the religiously informed mind as a purely biased participant in the public discourse. Religion was becoming a problem, not an aid in the formation of opinion and policy for the common good. Religion was inherently discriminatory, we were increasingly told, biased, exclusionary, racist even. Neuhaus discussed what he called the changeability of moral sentiment. Moreover, such change is inescapable, for we inhabit that change, which is history itself. Some change then is for the better. Neuhaus mentions improved race relations. Then Neuhaus mentions Adam Smith, who lived as a contemporary with the American founding fathers. Adam Smith, noted Neuhaus, confidently asserts that anyone who understands virtue would find abortion and infanticide to be utterly abhorrent. and Newhouse quotes the words of Alexander Pope, the 18th century poet. Vice is a monster of so frightful mien as to be hated needs but to be seen, yet too seen too oft. Familiar with her face, we first endure, then pity, then embrace. Newhouse comments, the monstrous becomes habitual, and we cannot afford but to be on friendly terms with our own habits. Already in 1984, the monstrous was rearing its head. Newhouse lists several, including the elimination of babies, if found effective, of allowing children to give lethal pills to their aged parents, thus allowing them to die with dignity. Interestingly, Newhouse gives this caution, 1984. One must now be careful not to be alarmist about these developments, for most of them, or these horrors, have not yet been adopted as policy. The extent to which the changing ability of moral sentiment has manifested itself in our day is utterly remarkable. But it is not only moral sentiment that has changed. The whole conceptual structure grounding the legitimacy of our law lies in tatters. Note, for example, the opening comments of Justice Kennedy, who wrote the majority opinion in the recent case concerning same-sex marriage. The Constitution promises liberty to all within its reach, a liberty that includes certain specific rights that allow persons within a lawful realm to define and express their identity. Now, traditionally, there is something that can be said for such language. A person indeed can choose the various arrangements into which he enters in order to give expression and to exercise his central commitments. The various rights granted in the Constitution, free speech, free press, association, religion, recognize these as organic aspects of man's natural status as a free being. But what Kennedy does, however, is to shift the focus from defining one's identity by way of external expression of that identity to defining the internal essential identity of the person himself. The Constitution, he claims, protects the rights of a person to define who she or he is. Add to this the contemporary fascination that sexual desire or orientation constitutes an identity, and one arrives at the conclusion that the Constitution promises and intends to protect the right to marry anyone of the same sex, meaning that the state now must recognize such marriages. And this with the corresponding implication that all who act in such manner as to restrict the exercise of that right are by definition acting themselves contrary to the Constitution and are subject to the various punishments of the state. The new contrived conundrum for those of traditional conviction is evident. The court decision promotes, indeed demands, that laws now be enacted which prohibit discrimination against sexual orientation and the marital status of same-sex couples. As a constitutional right, those new rights can be abridged only for what is called a compelling state interest. What that means is that religious objection to the new norm will in effect have to prove itself to possess a compelling state interest for itself to be upheld. Fair and balanced, ladies and gentlemen, this will not be. And events are proving this, unfortunately, to be the case. The transcendental grounding of law, constitutional and enacted, has given way to a personal identity claim based upon what John Adams called human passion. Not surprisingly, Chief Justice Roberts in his dissent called the decision an act of will, not legal judgment. Also this from Roberts. If an unvarying social institution enduring over all recorded history cannot inhibit judicial policymaking, then what can? Robert speaks of history. Marriage has been an unvarying social institution. Of course, that is correct. But in fact, recorded history has made a more fundamental claim concerning marriage, namely that it has been an unvarying social institution because marriage is, in truth, an arrangement which imprints itself upon human nature. And for this reason, and for no other reason, religious faiths have reflected on the institution of marriage and have given it spiritual value. In terms of biblical understanding, marriage climaxes the creation of man. It is not good for man to be alone. Unlike the sword, that is the state, the establishment of marriage lies within the garden and arises before the fall of man into sin and death. Why so? Because through the union of man and woman, and only through such union, does God continue to create life. Hence, marriage has intrinsically a forward dynamic. It inherently stretches toward the future and opens itself to a broader social reality. And in doing so, is an image of God's redemptive union with man, through which he wills the redemption of the whole world. Marriage is an image of Christ and his church. Of course, it is true and important that the biblical witness thinks of the state also as that which is instituted by God. Not only earthly powers, but human beings themselves must be limited. Yet it remains instructive that no mention of government occurs within the creation of him. The sword arises in view of man's sin. Whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed, for God made man in his own image. Earthly powers exist, therefore, only to maintain, protect, and prosper man. Overall, the scriptures do seem to advocate a respectful submission and obedience to earthly kingdoms. Let every person be subject to the governing authority. For there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by him. Thus, he who resists the authorities resists what God has appointed. Thus the Apostle Paul. In his small catechism, Luther includes good government under the prayer for our daily bread. For along with food, drink, money, spouse, property, good government is required for the well-being of man. Yet the Apostle Paul sets those very limits to earthly power which we have already seen. One should not resist authorities, for they are servants of God for your good. To restrain what is evil and to promote what is good. Thus one ought to pay taxes, give revenue, respect and honor to those to whom such is due. But what is evil and what is good? It's not within the wisdom or power of the state to decide. How best to restrain and to promote might be the matter of earthly wisdom. But for the Apostle Paul, at least, what is evil and what is good must be determined in view of the creation story itself. God made and saw that it was good. That is to say, what he made is apt to be the instrument for the promotion of human welfare. It is not good that man should be alone. The arrangement of marriage according to nature belongs to that which is good. In view of the recent SCOTUS decision, the condition of religious liberty for the Christian faithful is dire. And this in both directions. We have emphasized the need for a limited government relative to human freedom. In conclusion, I must mention the fact that the SCOTUS decision raises the issue of legitimacy of this court and of the government which will enforce it. I have briefly outlined contours of Christian conviction, in view of which the question of legitimacy also arises. If fundamental law of the nation is contrary to the natural order, that is, to the creative will of God, and an enacted law works to compromise Christian conviction, which is central and fundamental to Christian understanding, and indeed inhibits or even inhibits or even prohibits the exercise of Christian mercy and care, then the extent to which the Christian chooses to participate in the nation's life is very much in question. To some extent, the state itself may limit such participation. In view of the Camp David saga, one might well ask just what governmental office a practicing Christian might hold and still preserve their conscience intact. I know for a fact that those questions are arising within the military chaplaincy. Nor am I alone in raising these questions. In his dissent, Justice Alito wrote that the decision reveals the deep and perhaps irremediable corruption of our legal culture's conception of constitutional interpretation. Scalia wrote of the court's hubris. When we consider the question concerning the body of Christ in the public square, the issue is, as always, the question of Pilate to Christ: what is truth? Religious conviction gives answer to that question. It is the proper role of the earthly power to allow and to protect the living out of that answer. That is the point of the notion of religious liberty. Christian liberty, however, is of a different order. Jesus said, "The truth shall set you free." That saying occurs in the Gospel of John, in which Gospel Jesus identifies himself to be the truth. The freedom of the Christian man lies in the new commandment of Christ, to love God and one's neighbor, and in that order. That freedom is not from the state, cannot be given. That freedom is not from the state, cannot be given by the state, and cannot be taken away by the state. As he who is free, the Christian stands in the world as a living testimony of a kingdom which is not of this world. Regardless of the claims of civil society, the Christian, if he is to remain that living testimony, must remain true to the truth. One who comes as the bridegroom of his church, his wife, and through the forgiveness of sins brings forth children for God the Father. The recurring confession of the ancient martyr before the Roman magistrate was, "Christianus sum," I am Christian. In this, our strange moment, when the changeability of moral sentiment appears hostile and fraught with danger, that must, I submit to you, remain our witness. Christianus sum. Without it, there will be no living witness to the living God in the midst of our culture. Thank you, Rachel.